Hello, 3D printing friends. Today on the BV3D channel, we'll take a look at the BIQ H2 Compact Direct Drive Extruder. Stick around and we'll get into it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. Hi, welcome back. Hey, if you're new here and you're wanting to learn about 3D printing, 3D modeling, and other 3D printing related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Okay, so today we're going to take a look at the BIQ H2 extruder. As many people know, there are two general kinds of extrusion systems on 3D printers that use filament. Some employ a Bowden-drive extruder system. This is a system in which the extruder motor, the motor which pushes the filament, is somewhat removed from the hot end. The motor is generally mounted to the X-axis arm and pushes filament through a Teflon tube to get it into the nozzle. It doesn't move with the hot end, and so the tube and the filament within it have to flex to accommodate the hot end's motion. As a result of the distance between the extruder motor and the hot end and the amount of play between the filament and the tube, some kinds of filament, particularly flexible filament, yes, I'm looking at UTPU, can be difficult to print. Other printers use a direct drive system. This is a system in which the extruder motor is mounted directly above the hot end and pushes filament straight down into the nozzle. The path from the extruder motor to the hot end is short. It's just a straight shot. Flexible filaments are easier to print because they're being pushed directly down into the nozzle without the opportunity to bunch up in a long tube. It's possible to convert a Bowden-drive 3D printer to a direct drive, but most solutions simply move the existing extruder motor from the side of the X-axis arm to the X-carriage, basically shortening the Teflon tube to the minimum length necessary, and often becoming quite tall in the process. Apart from the weight of the additional 3D printed or metal parts needed to mount the extruder motor, this doesn't add a lot of mass to the X-axis overall. But it does move the mass of the stepper motor and the mounting components to the X-carriage. In a Bowden setup, the printer doesn't have to sling the extruder motor's mass back and forth while it prints, but in a direct drive setup, it does. In an effort to provide a direct drive extrusion system with the smallest possible size and mass, BIQ has produced the H2. In design, it appears very similar to the E3D Hemera, and before you yell, "Clone!" I'd like to point out that, superficially, they both remind me of the direct drive extruder on my Monoprice Maker Select Plus, with the addition of a geared filament drive system to increase their filament pushing power. Like other direct drive modifications for the Ender 3 series, this one is a DIY affair. So let's see what comes in the kit. You get the H2 extruder, gearbox, stepper motor, and hot end assembly. You get a heater cartridge, a thermistor, a 30mm fan, a grill for the 30mm fan, a cable for the stepper motor, Allen keys, screws, an info sheet, and the traditional BIQ/Big Tree Tech rubber ducky. All the cables included in the kit are about 1 meter in length. That's a problem, and I'll explain why in a little bit. Now, because this can be mounted on many different makes and models of printers and in many different ways, there are no mounting plates included. Now, fortunately, printable mounting plates can be downloaded from BIQ's website for different printers. For example, there are printable mounts available for the Ender 3 and 3 Pro, and for the Ender 3 V2. There are also printable fan mounts, so you can continue to use the stock part's cooling fan. Now, I found the stock fan to be inadequate when used with the H2, so I tried a couple of other fan mounts that I found on Thingiverse, one for a 4020 blower and one for a 5015 blower. The one for the 4020 blower used a ring type of duct, and the one for the 5015 blower used a duct similar to the one on the Prusa Mark III. In testing, I found the 5015 blower with the Mark III style duct to be the best of the three, so that's what I've got mounted here. And, you know, I realized after having had this 5015 blower on the printer for several weeks that the mount was blocking airflow across part of the heatsink that cools the heat break. Now, I haven't had a problem with heat creep or filament jam, so apparently I have enough airflow to keep this cool, but I may redesign that mount to allow more airflow across the heatsink. If you don't mind messy wiring, you can zip tie the H2's wires for the heater, thermistor, fan, and stepper motor to the outside of the existing cable sleeves, but I wanted this to look nice, so I completely removed the wiring harnesses from the printer. I pulled the wires from the sleeves, and then I put them inside this reinforced textile sleeve instead. I like the look of it. It's similar to that split loom cable cover stuff, so getting the wires inside is easy. It has enough rigidity to keep itself from flopping over, but it also has enough flexibility to bend where it needs to. I know other people have disassembled their H2 and rotated the stepper motor such that the connector is on the top, but I like the cleaner appearance of having the connector on the bottom. I've got all the wires neatly bundled and routed together, and I think it looks pretty good. Besides the necessity of printing a mount and a fan duct and replacing the stock parts cooling blower with one that has greater airflow, I also added a PTFE coupler and a very short length of PTFE tubing to the input side of the extruder. Otherwise, the filament is just going to go down into a large threaded hole. Using the coupler and the tubing helps to guide the filament down into the hot end. And this also allows you to do what's called a reverse Bowden setup, in which, yes, you have a Bowden tube coming off the extruder, but it's simply a guide. The filament gets pulled through it, not pushed. You may have seen other videos where I have the spool holder mounted to the front left corner of the printer. That's where I like to put it because it's easy for me to get to, it's easy for me to see how much filament I have left, it reduces the overall height of the printer, and it's not in the way of any of the wiring. But that position doesn't work well for a direct drive extruder. Direct drives tend to work best with the spool holder at the top of the printer. By using a reverse Bowden setup, the filament input for the extruder is moved to wherever the open end of that tube is. So I could, if I wanted, design a clip for the open end of the tube and mount it right over here where the original extruder motor was, and then I could keep the spool holder at the left front where I like it. Now, I said this was a DIY kit, and frankly, it was a little more DIY than I was expecting. As I mentioned a moment ago, this can be mounted on many different makes and models of printers and in many different ways. And as a result, there really aren't any step-by-step installation instructions. So you need to have a good idea of how a direct drive extruder should be connected in order to be able to pull this off. And you need a good sense of how the X carriage on your printer works and where things can be attached to it. Now, there were a couple of issues that I ran into. For instance, the printable Ender 3 V2 mount makes use of a couple of threaded mounting holes on the X carriage. But the Ender 3 V2 that I was mounting this on is a very early production model, and its X carriage doesn't have the same hole pattern as later ones. In fact, it only had one of the two holes that were needed, and that hole wasn't threaded, plus it was too large a diameter for an M3 bolt. So I needed to add the missing hole. I removed the X carriage from the printer and marked where the second hole needed to be, and then drilled and tapped it for an M3 bolt. For the hole that was already there, I'm just using an M3 nut around the back side of it. Now, this issue is probably exceedingly rare, and really it's more of a Creality issue than a BIQ one. Now, I mentioned this X-carriage issue on a previous video, and a viewer recently commented that they had the same problem, and they brought it up to Creality support, and Creality is sending them a new one with the correct hole pattern, free of charge. Another issue that I had with the printed mount is that it had exactly zero accommodations for securing the hot end wiring. I didn't want to have the hot end cable bundle just kind of flopping around, so I imported that mount's STL file into Tinkercad, and I made some modifications. Couple of prototypes later, and I had a mounting solution that I liked with places for zip ties that keeps everything in place. Speaking of the wiring, the thermistor cable and the heater cartridge cable and the fan and stepper motor wires are just too short to reach the main board on the printer. So I ended up reusing the stock heater cartridge, and I made extension cables for the thermistor, heat brake fan, and stepper motor. There was a fair bit of connector crimping involved, and I discovered that the more you crimp, the better you get at it. And it should also be noted that installing the H2 with a printable adapter plate means that the nozzle is going to be somewhere between 10 and 15 millimeters forward of the bed when the Y-axis is homed. It's not a huge deal, but I did want to mention it. So, after installing the H2, you should perform a PID tuning on your printer's hot end. The settings in your firmware are tuned for the stock hot end, and so you're very likely to see issues with the printer not being able to keep the nozzle temperature locked in where you set it. Speaking from experience, this can make it hard to get your print settings dialed in for the H2. Yes, I made a rookie mistake when I first installed the H2, and I completely forgot to run Marlin Firmware's PID AutoTune so that the printer would be able to accurately control the nozzle temperature. I was having a hard time getting the stringing under control, and I was noticing weird issues on the retraction test models. The temperature swings were close to about 10 degrees Celsius, and the little towers on the retraction tests had a very regular, ridged look to them, because the filament's appearance varies with the printing temperature. But once I ran the PID AutoTune, the printer was able to keep the nozzle locked in at my set printing temperature, and I was able to get the retraction dialed in. So if you want to know how to do that, I've got a video linked in the description to show you how to run Marlin's PID AutoTune on the Ender 3 V2. Now let's talk about print settings for a minute. I use Prusa Slicer for darn near everything, but these settings should translate over to your slicer of choice fairly easily. Direct drive extruders don't need a lot of retraction, and so I'm using a retraction distance of 0.6 millimeters, no Z-hop, a retraction speed of 60 millimeters per second, and a D-retraction speed of 40 millimeters per second. I have it set to retract on layer changes, perform a wipe while it's retracting, and it retracts 70% before it begins the wipe. With these settings, stringing is really very minimal. Also, it may not actually need to perform that wipe, so you can try your own variation on the settings. If you're looking for that wipe setting in Cura, I think it's called coasting. Okay, so here are some of the things that I've printed with the H2, all with a 0.2 millimeter layer height. I have a variety of vases, or vases, depending on your pronunciation. I usually say vase, but for the rest of this video, I'm going to try pronouncing it vase. It sounds fancy. So I printed most of these in PLA and a couple in PPU. I also have a couple of Calicat models, a standard XYZ calibration cube, a couple of tripod wall mount hangers that I designed, and I have a retraction test, and Luby's Aria Dragon. I also have a Benchy, so let's start there. This Benchy came out pretty good. If you look really, really closely, you can see a couple of little strings inside the wheelhouse, but there are no major issues. And the overhangs look really good in the doorways and at the bottom of the bow. The stringing test has a few little wisps, but that's about it. The columns came out nice and even. The calibration cube came out great. There's no issues, and the top surface looks really smooth. This little Calicat is also good. There's a little stringing between the body and the tail, but the 45-degree angle on the tail looks good. Sometimes that part likes to curl a bit if you don't have good cooling, but I put that 50-15 blower on the H2, so I think it's doing pretty good. This bigger Calicat is one that I printed in Polymaker's Polyterra Orange PLA. It's got a matte finish, which seems to highlight any imperfections in the print. So, some of this stuff that looks like it might be Z-banding, I don't think it is. These seem to be directly tied to features on the model itself, like the whiskers, the nose, and the eyes. I've seen that sort of thing on Benchy prints too, on the layers where the deck gets printed. Now, I don't know specifically why that happens though. If you have any thoughts or theories on that, let me know in the comments. On this tripod wall hanger that I printed in the Polyterra, the effect is less noticeable. I printed a second one in a marble PLA, and it's hard to see any issues at all. I think the marble PLA's glossy finish and the little dark flecks really hide the layer lines and imperfections. And I think Aria turned out pretty good too. But now let's get to the vases. Printed in spiral vase mode with what I consider normal settings, with the 0.2 millimeter layers at about 45 millimeters per second, this low poly faceted vase came out great. It takes about an hour, but it comes out fine. And this was with the stock Ender 3 V2 parts cooling blower. One of the things you should be able to do with a direct drive extruder that has a geared drive system like the H2 is print faster without the extruder stepper motor skipping steps. And you can definitely do that with the H2, but if you want to go fast, heat is your enemy and parts cooling is your friend. Using the stock parts cooling blower and slicing it to print at 100 millimeters per second, the vase only takes 24 minutes to print, but the layers don't have time to cool sufficiently before the next layer goes on. And so the heat builds up, the plastic stays soft, and then the corners start to curl up on some of these little overhangs, and you kind of get this sort of effect. Once the diameter of the vase gets big enough that one layer has enough time to cool before the nozzle comes back around for the next layer, that effect goes away. And interestingly, it stays away as long as the overhangs are on the inside of the vase, but once the overhangs start being on the outside again, the effect returns. Printing the exact same file, but replacing the stock parts cooling blower with the 5015 blower and the Prusa-style duct significantly reduced the appearance of that effect, and it kept the same 24-minute print time. So I think fast printing is one area where there are definitely a bunch of factors to take into account to get good results. There may be some models that just won't print well if you print them fast, and others may work just fine. Now, I tried to print this other vase model in a nice flexible TPU filament, and the first time I tried, I noticed that the nozzle was kind of pulling the model along with it, so the layers weren't lining up quite right as it printed. So I cut the print speed in half while it was printing, and it started to look good again. So I stopped that print and re-sliced it to print at a slower speed, and I thought maybe it would finish, and then I'd have a nice squishy vase. Now this time I got a much better result, but once it got to a certain height, the vase was just too floppy and it started to fail again. So I canceled that one too. I think if I experiment with speed and extrusion width, I may be able to get a vase printed in TPU that actually finishes. Now if I take this model and scale it up to fit the printer's build height, and I use the spiral vase mode settings that I used for that first gray faceted vase, Prusa Slicer says this will take a little over 6 hours to print, and Prusa Slicer is ridiculously accurate with these estimates. But if I set every single print speed setting to 100 millimeters per second and then slice it, Prusa Slicer says it'll take about 2 hours and 20 minutes to print. Now I know that due to acceleration settings and whatnot, the printer isn't going to realize that 100 millimeter per second speed. And that's the difference between actual print speed and commanded speed. I'm commanding the printer to move at 100 millimeters per second, and it's going to try, but its actual speed will be less. But it will print pretty darn fast, and in fact, the actual print time for this vase was 2 hours 23 minutes, and I figure that extra 3 minutes was due to the nozzle in the bed getting up temperature. So the H2 is definitely capable of high-speed printing. I think you just have to find the right balance of settings, model geometry, and filament. So that's the BIQU H2 Compact Direct Drive Extruder. It's a DIY project that can give you some pretty great results, but with the included wires being too short for an Ender 3 series printer, they're likely too short for a great many other printers too. I think if BIQU doubled or tripled the length of the wires, you'd probably be able to install this on even a big printer with a 300x300x400 build volume without having to make a bunch of extension cables. Also, the STL files available from BIQU for the printable mounting brackets and the parts cooling ducts may not be the greatest, but you can search and find other ones like I did for the parts cooling ducts, or you can modify existing mounts or even design your own. So as impressive as the H2 is, just be aware that installing it is not a project for the faint of heart. You need to be comfortable working with your printer's wiring, and you need to be good at crimping connectors onto cables. That said, if it aligns with your skill set, it seems to be a worthwhile upgrade. And again, thanks to BIQU for sending this to me to test out, and there's a link to the H2 and BIQU site in the description. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this episode. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool. Hey, real quick before you go, I wanted to say thanks for being one of the super awesome people who sticks around all the way to the end, and thanks for all the likes, comments, and shares. And an especially big thanks to those who directly support what I do. You're all wonderful for doing that, and I really appreciate it. If you liked this episode, a thumbs up would be great, and if you'd like to help support the channel, check the description for ways you can do exactly that. And hey, if you haven't already subscribed, please do. It's absolutely free, and it's an excellent way to help keep me making these videos for you. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time here on the BV3D channel.